I'm pleased to be here on behalf of InnovaCorp and Cove, some new efforts at entrepreneurship and innovation in the ocean space. So my name is Justin Manley. By way of sort of as brief a self-introduction as I can, I have a long history in maritime robotics. I built robots for the ocean at MIT for many, many years. Left that and sponsored their development in the U.S. National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. And eventually I saw the light and became a private sector individual and jumped over to a startup company. We're going to talk a little bit about that. And then with a very large corporation in the space called Teledyne Marine. These days I run my own consulting practice largely because corporate got corporate. I joined a startup. Startup failed, as they sort of do. And almost a year and a half, 2 years later, I'm still doing things like this and working with a whole bunch of different innovative companies and technologies. So it's great fun. We're going to talk here today about sort of a hybrid of things, but marine robotics is sort of the core, but with really an eye towards entrepreneurship and innovation and a little bit more about it from the business angle as opposed to from the science and technology side. I do like to start just with the sense of the crowd. Does anybody here work in the maritime or ocean space at all? Okay, cool. So we got a little bit of maritime knowledge. Excellent. This next one's a ringer. Who's an entrepreneur? Right. Wait, what about the rest of you? Did you mow lawns ever as a kid? Right? I mean, at some point, I really like to remind people, this is designed to inspire entrepreneurship and innovation. If you think hard at it, you know, unless you're a really highly conventional human being who just like went to school and then got an ordinary job, you've probably had an entrepreneurial experience in your life one way or another. And hopefully you'll see out of this that there's a lot of ways to approach that in the ocean tech space. So the corollary was, if you're not an entrepreneur, you're not supposed to raise your hand and say you're interested in being an entrepreneur, because those are your alternatives. Otherwise, again, you go back into that box of sort of regular life. I do need to make an acknowledgement. So one of the benefits of what I do, I chair a lot of conference tracks and working groups and panels, and so I have the opportunity to get exposed to a lot of material. You're going to see a fair bit of that here, right? So you're going to see other people's content. In all cases, it should be properly cited and acknowledged where it came from. In the event I made a mistake, my apologies. But this is the work of a whole community of people. I'm just a talking head here for the most part. So, part of threes, we're going to talk about three things: all parties, all stories, beginning, a middle, and an end. Talk a little bit about the technology. So those of you from outside the space, we may slow down and be a little more basic about what these technologies are. We're going to talk about the markets, applications. What are they good for? Who cares, right? At the end of the day, if you're in business, doesn't matter how cool the technology is if nobody cares. And then hopefully there'll be some actual case studies, and this isn't like a Harvard Business School case study. This is like a couple of slides and a few words, case study of some things going on to show you how entrepreneurs and companies are innovating and thriving in this particular market. So, you know, those are not jelly beans, even though they look like brightly colored little tasty things. This is kind of one slide designed to show you the fact that there is a great variety in this technology we call autonomous undersea vehicles. So if you're at all maritime-minded, you might say those look like torpedoes, right? So depending on who you ask, torpedoes may have been the first autonomous underwater vehicle. They weren't particularly clever, nor did they come back very often. But they were an example of a lot of sophisticated technology. So for example, if you go back in the history and were to open up a World War II-era torpedo, essentially sort of the clockwork, steampunk-looking mechanisms that made those things work were really quite impressive, right? They could control distance and speed and depth underwater and what direction they went. And they did all of that without the stuff we have, right? Without the goodies, right? We all kind of become dependent on the electronics and the software. They didn't have any of that. Today they do, and this is a mature market. There are companies that manufacture and sell these vehicles, global companies, European, some Asian, a fair bit in North America, particularly in New England. So I'm from the Boston area, and we have several of the leading companies there. So that's sort of one flavor. These things move around like a torpedo would in a straight line, and basically their real purpose is to get you into the ocean and either cover a large area of seafloor, right? So you want to make a map of the seafloor, you want to find something, or go up and down in the water column to study oceanographic phenomena or something like that. There's a whole nother category, And again, just to give you a sense of flavor, two different things going on here in one slide. So the stuff on the right in the middle, we call those gliders. What's really neat about these things, they fit on this table. You know, they're about the length of that table. They're not terribly expensive in this market, so $150,000 to $250,000. So a lot more expensive than, say, a car. But as compared to a ship that can cost $50,000 a day to operate, they've got a high value proposition. If you followed the news, the Chinese picked up a U.S. Navy undersea vehicle, it would have looked just like that one in the middle. And in fact, Dalhousie University, where we were this morning, has vehicles that are just like the ones the U.S. Navy used, right? It truly is a science instrument. And it turns out they all want to study the same thing in the ocean. So that's pretty cool because those things can stay out for up to a few months, in some cases over a year, in the ocean. So all of a sudden you've got one system out there collecting a lot of data relatively affordably. Lots of neat technology, but we're not going to talk about that right now. Whole different approach to going out and staying in the ocean for a long time is what you see along the bottom. And for scale, and it's blown up, that's a human being. And you can see the human being in the circle. That is a submarine that would fill this room. It's completely robotic and unmanned. So Boeing built that. That vehicle can carry enough energy that it can run for months. And it can essentially act just like you might think of a full-size submarine, but it does it all robotically. Really neat vehicle, really neat technology. Gives you a sense of the spectrum of what's going on out there. We go from small little things that fit on the table to things the size of this room, and all of them have differing capabilities. There's a whole nother cadre. So pretty much everything we just showed you is designed to kind of go in a straight line. The gliders kind of do a motion like that. Everything else drives straight. All of these, more like a helicopter or a blimp approach. They can move very, very slowly, and they can move in lots of different directions. That starts to matter if you think about an oil rig, right? An oil rig, kind of like the tables here, it's got legs and structure. It can be hard to maneuver around that, but if you can move slowly and in multiple directions, degrees of freedom is the robotic geek term, you can access those areas. And so that's those four there. There's a new technology coming into play. Where's my mouse? No mouse. There we go. If this video plays for us, looks like a sea snake. Right? This is a new robotic technology, and as you can see, it's very, very maneuverable. Right? This is a whole new approach to trying to get inside these complex environments, and typically it's an inspection task. You've got to go in just like you'd inspect the underside of a bridge. You've got to inspect these oil platforms. So lots of cool new technology going on. That's a startup company in Norway. Right? So that company is about a year and a half old, and they're pushing that product out. Another small company with a neat tech. You can sort of see, it may not be entirely clear, but that looks like a fish. It's modeled on a tuna. Again, it fits on this table. And what's really pretty exciting is that we've developed the robotic mechanical skill to actually emulate the fish. Right? Interesting question, of course, becomes what's it good for? And that's one of the challenges I'm working with this client on, is to sort of find the areas where that does a better job than any of these other technologies we've talked about. Just because the Navy sponsored the R&D doesn't mean there's a market. So we're still working on that. We've got some really interesting ideas, but you've got to factor that in as you advance into these industries. Apologies for basically showing you the equivalent of a wall poster, but it seemed like the easiest way to capture a really compelling story. This was presented, the whole slide deck on this was presented a few weeks ago in San Diego. The company here is called Stone Aerospace. And with funding from NASA, they have been building an undersea robot that will first tunnel through ice in Antarctica. Then it will punch through the ice and swim around underneath. The really cool thing, okay, that's great. You know, I did a job in 1993. We cut a hole in the ice and put a robot in and it swam around. But this uses lasers. It does two really amazing things with lasers. One, it's using a laser as the drill. So they've actually developed a laser at a wavelength that essentially melts the water ahead of it, or the ice, excuse me, turns it into water, right? So that's really, really cool. And then they're essentially pushing laser energy down a fiber optic line to actually power the robot, right? So, I mean, it's some insane technology. Is there a market there? Well, NASA wanted this one for a test. But this company is also developing some interesting other products. But this is kind of the cutting edge stuff in this space, really compelling, challenging problems being solved. changing gears from underwater to on the surface of the water. This may look like a whole bunch of boats, and it sort of is, except all of these are designed to run without any people on board for a variety of reasons. In this case, we're looking at military markets. So for example, the one on the top left is designed after a mine has been found. It swims over, drops what's called an ROV, which is a remote-controlled robot that swims down and deploys a neutralizer so that you can take that mine out of commission, and it does it all essentially on the end of a remote control. People back on shore, back on ship, miles away, right? Pretty cool. Also kind of cool from a business model perspective, the ones on the bottom, they're designed to be shot at. They're training aids, right? So if you ever sort of thought about if you're a naval officer and you got that really big gun on the front of the ship, how do you learn how to shoot it, right? Well, you got to shoot at something to get good. They use things like this as training aids. And it's such a great business model because if your customer's good, well, they sunk it and they got to buy another one. If they're only sort of good, they damage it and they still pay you to repair it, right? Great fun going to the factory and saw about a half dozen of those with a bunch of holes in it, right? So it's a neat idea. Is it a great big giant business? Well, probably not. But it's another way you kind of insert some interesting tech into an application. Then there's another variety for civilian purposes. And again, pick the one second over, the yellow Z-boat. That also is about the size of a table, right? So just to give you some context. And what's really happened here is with the power of technology, you can make that little boat go out and do survey patterns and map the seafloor, go out and figure out is it safe to get a cargo vessel through, really quite affordably. My favorite little piece of that story is the first robot I built was about the same size, and we couldn't make it cross the Charles River in Boston. And the reason we couldn't is there was no GPS that could fit on the 4-foot boat that had the performance we needed, right? And that wasn't that much performance. So again, if you think back, and that was, call that 1993, 94, right? So some of these fundamental changes in technology have enabled these whole new industries relatively quickly. Then there's another neat category. What I like is everything on this slide, these are all relatively young companies, right? We'll call them startups for the sake of this conversation. Top left, the product is called Datamaran. Yeah, it looks like a little catamaran sailboat. One of the really neat things that they have some IP on is if that thing gets knocked over due to wind and waves, and now if you've ever sailed, you know, the catamaran is on its side, what are we going to do here, right? Normally, if you fell off the catamaran, you go back and you use your body weight and try to flip it over. In this case, the sail has an actuator, and the sail basically pushes down, changes the buoyancy, and flips the thing back over. Right? All of that can be done robotically, and it can make its own decision about, has the weather calmed down enough now that I should even bother, or should I just hang on and get bounced around? Another interesting tidbit, that company is pursuing more of a service business model. So instead of selling their robots, what they're hoping to do is build up enough of a fleet and let you charter it by day rate. It's a leasing model, effectively, instead of a sales model. Bottom left, the company's called Autonaut. They use wave energy to make that boat go. It's based on a patent, if I recall correctly, that was filed in like 1897. So what's really kind of cool is you'll never see, well, I've yet to see a photo of that. Underneath, at the front and the back, there are some fins. I've never really seen a good photo of those fins. They're illustrated in the patent, but of course, a patent from 1897 doesn't have any value anymore, right? So the trade secrets, their approach as a startup to making their product go is an interesting challenge, because eventually, if you push enough of your product into the market, your trade secrets are going to get known to some degree, right? So it's a neat problem. They're doing great work. Submarine in the middle is another interesting one. It looks kind of like a windsurfer, right, if you've ever been on a windsurfing board. But A, it does all of that robotically and autonomously. And B, they can fold the sail down, and they can make that whole thing sink underwater and then surface back up, right? The initial application is actually safety, right? If you're out, it turns out in global shipping lanes, sometimes the best way to avoid getting run over is to be underwater. Right. Also, you might imagine certain defense reasons, right? They happen to be in San Diego and have a lot of Navy customers. But another neat product. Last but not least, Sail Drone. So Sail Drone is another fun story. The founder was very interested in land speed records, and he was creating land speed yachts. If you've ever sort of seen these, they're for high speed sailing over roads or over salt flats. And he transitioned into this space, raised some capital from originally from Google sources, so some Google-made millionaires have funded his company. and he's out there building a robot sailboat. So again, all of these companies have come on the scene in the past sort of 5 years. All of them are making initial sales and are making initial revenue. I don't know anything about any of their underlying financials, but it's a pretty interesting field to have come together. Will they all be here in 3 to 5 years? I don't know, but it certainly will be fun to watch. So this is a classic slide coming out of somebody whose title is Deputy Assistant Secretary of the Navy, right? So retired General Frank Kelly is the Deputy Assistant Secretary of the U.S. Navy for all unmanned systems. So they've given this gentleman the prerogative to understand and manage that approach. And what's interesting is you start to see these general statements about enabling technologies, increasing capabilities, right? And a couple of things to think about. We're talking about robotics, right? The system in the middle, the close-in weapon system that's designed to protect ships from missiles, that's been a robotic weapon system on ships for a few decades, because it turns out a human being can't possibly manage it fast enough. The whole thing's been handed over to a series of algorithms designed to shoot down missiles, right? The ship coming over from it is a full-size vessel designed for anti-submarine warfare, no people. It's a completely unmanned vessel. It looks like a ship. It's got a pretty cool trimaran design, but it goes out and does its job all autonomously. Down below, a few more technologies, but if we sum it all up, what I like taking away from the Navy messaging is, as an enterprise user, let's call them that, right? Big institutional user, they're all about combining robotic technologies and human operators, right? That's the nice little clip art of a robot shaking hands with a person, right? So the message here is we bring these things together to derive added value. A little different narrative than if you're reading the press about, you know, robots destroying jobs, right? Here they look very much at it as a synergy. Another trend, and this also was presented at the same conference a couple of weeks ago, a company called Seabite coming out of the UK. They're probably 10, 11 years old now. They had a successful exit a couple of years ago. They were acquired. This company grew to 40, 50 people. All they do is sell software and algorithms. They don't make any hardware, right? And they push all of this into the maritime space. They do work with defense. They do work with oil and gas. You can kind of get a sense of the diversity of their clientele. But essentially, they became an expert shop in making robotic systems smarter and more capable. So if you're intrigued by this field and all of this discussion about boats and floating and water tightness is intimidating, you know, there's room for ones and zeros here too, right? And this was a quite successful company. They take a little bit of a closed ecosystem approach. Naturally enough, competitor is on the scene. This company is called Green Sea. Their product suite is called Open Sea. You can sort of sense that they take a more open approach. Basically the same business model. They push out software, algorithms, and deliver service value to their customers. They're in Vermont, and again, technically, they're probably about a 10-year-old company. They've really hit their growth stride in the last couple of years, right? So these things are growing and starting to hit the market. And one last final plug. So NOC, the National Oceanography Center in the UK, has recently planted a flag and said, marine robotics, we're in. And you can see that they're starting to invest meaningful sums and staff resources in creating their own marine robotics ecosystem. This is in the south of England, in Southampton. And last but not least, and apologies if it's hard to read, I took this picture on the airplane yesterday. Yesterday was Sunday. This is last Thursday's Financial Times. Rolls-Royce, £200 million investment in research and development for autonomous ships. This isn't the little boats I've just been showing you pictures of. This is full-size ships like you see being built down the waterfront here, completely autonomous. Again, £200 million. This is an immense investment. The other thing that's interesting to me, if you look at it, if you were to read this article, it talks about how, so Rolls-Royce, big company, right, multinational, had cut its maritime staff by 25% due to a lot exposure to oil and gas primarily. Now they're reinvesting in unmanned systems. Right, so this, what I hope you take away from this is that this is a real deal, big markets, big money, and you can bet that that kind of impact, we're going to see it probably sooner than we might have actually expected out there on the harbor and certainly in the ocean. All right. You may not care about the AUVs, right? Because this may have all been whatever. This is interesting. You're here at Volta. You're all entrepreneurs. Maybe this was utterly uninteresting. So we're going to shift gears and try to get you interested by talking about the money. So the first thing about money, right? You all know this. If you've got a business and a service, what do you need? Customer, or at least value, right? You can raise money without customers as long as you have a value proposition, right? So now you can have a company and you can pay yourself and you can claim ownership and all this stock, and that's great. Ideally, you're going to need the customers, but you need a value proposition. This is a case study from a company I used to work for, and at the end of the day, the U.S. Navy would go out and collect a certain kind of data with a ship. It cost them $10,000 to collect one data set. With the undersea vehicles, that same glider we talked about, they can collect the same data set for $100, right? Also, the ship, running the ship, costs them roughly $50,000 a day. They can buy that glider for $150,000, right? So what you see here to, again, an enterprise user is huge improvement in operations and maintenance expenditure and a dramatic decrease in capital expenditure. That's a value proposition that is profound, right? So with a value proposition, what does that mean for a market, right? Is the Navy going to buy 10 and is that it? Nope. One of the analysts in the field, Douglas Westwood, this is a snapshot from an executive summary of one of their very, very lengthy reports, right? But conveniently, they give you the highlights. This is number of units, right? And they're sort of showing in 2015 when I was looking at it, you know, I was looking at North America because that was a market I knew, and they said there were 400. And that's probably about right. So now you see coming into this year, this is a global market measured close to 1,000 units, okay? This is not iPhone volume, right? But that's still a lot.
What would be the average price just that the audience?
Well, so funny you ask. So we convert that into dollars, right? And another market firm says it's a $1 billion market. The challenge here, when you look at this and you say, okay, if there were 400 units in North America, rounded up to 600, getting you to $1 billion, if they were $250,000 units versus $1 million units, it sort of makes a difference, and it's a blend, is the short answer. There are those vehicles I started with, some of the largest ones can be $5 million at a pop. Those gliders can be down below $200,000. I'll show you in a little bit some technology that's probably going to upend these economics as well. But so we got a $1 billion market, right? That's sort of interesting, right? It's better than a $1 million market. So to hopefully convince you that money can be made, we'll tell you a little bit of a story that I was personally involved in. So the Wave Glider is a robot boat. The company's called Liquid Robotics. The short version of how the technology works is it captures the difference in energy in a wave from low to high. And this turns, a wave goes up and down, and this turns up and down into forward, right? So you get free propulsion out of this approach. And then throw some solar panels on to run your electronics, and you've got an ocean-going robot that's basically an indefinite platform. Not very fast, right? This isn't going to win any speed records, but if you're not going to run out of fuel, if you're not going to run out of energy, you can afford to take your time. It's a classic turtle hair kind of story. You can put these things out, and they'll get the job done. So the technology, back in 2009, looked like that. For those of you with maritime tech experience, you kind of look at the little plastic watertight box on deck there. This looks like a classic student project. You see this in universities, right? They get a watertight box, they drill some holes, they put some connectors through, right? So that's what the product, well, it wasn't even a product, that's what the prototype looked like. And that's what it looks like now. And this is just one of those nice marketing slides. Again, companies grow, you get great photos, you get great statistics, right? And technology readiness level, that's an often a defense term. But this is a product in the market. And I think the fun number, right, whenever this slide was generated, 1.1 million nautical miles traveled. Anybody a frequent flyer? Anybody hit 1 million miles on your airline? I did. And I sat down and I figured out how much time that meant going 500 miles an hour that I spent in airplanes. Right, and it's when you sit down and think about how much of your life in airplanes leaks to 1 million miles, going 500 miles an hour, and then you think about how long it took to get 1 million miles at essentially 1 mile an hour. Point of that story is these things have seen a lot of sea time, and that's part of the challenge in an ocean tech business, is that you don't have to do 1 million miles, but you really got to get your product in service, you got to beat it up, you got to go through maybe not 17 hurricanes, but you should probably go through a hurricane or two to really have confidence in your technology so that your market adopts it, right? So what does it take? How long does it take? What's the issue there? So classically, ocean tech companies grow very, very slowly. There are many here in the area that can be decades, 30, 40 years old. They may still have 25 employees, right? Liquid Robotics took a different approach, raised a pretty significant amount of venture capital. And what you see here, again, we realize it's sort of a 10-year timeline. But if you look at this through the eyes of a fairly complex product technology company, a lot went on here. Went from prototype to product, created a whole second generation of product that learned all the lessons from the first and brought a better value add. By the end of last year, 16, over 400 units in service. All of this in about 10 years. And late last year had a very successful acquisition by Boeing, big defense contractor. This may not sound all that compelling to the average entrepreneur who thinks, well, I want to sell my company in 3 to 5 years. I don't want to take 10 years, and I want to sell it to, you know, Salesforce, because I think I'll make more money than if I get bought by Boeing, right? If you just look at stock multipliers, right? That's all true, but this validated a really important question, right? Can you successfully take a VC approach and actually make money in the ocean tech space? And the fact that we did, and that the numbers had enough zeros on it in terms of investment and exit value, this is an important flag in the field, right? So you can do this. You don't have to do this, but it can be done. Or you can do what this company, Deep Trekker, has done. So Deep Trekker is a Canadian company. They came out of the Waterloo innovation ecosystem, not at all affiliated with the ocean space. So the founder had a history in enterprise sales. With a BlackBerry, and I believe it was also with Xerox, right? So an individual who knew about putting technology products in the hands of customers at some volume, got affiliated with a gentleman, had some cool technology ideas, and we won't go into it, but this is a small, remotely operated robot, right? Company's, I think, 5 years old, 6 years old this year. As of the beginning of this year, they had 26 employees, and they're predicting 36 by the end of this year, right? Okay, that may not sound like a lot compared to certain IT companies, but that's pretty dramatic growth in this industry. And some of the ways they've achieved that growth, you can sort of see the similarity in all of these things. And you don't have to be an expert, but I'll tell you, the top product and the bottom product, very different price points, almost a factor of 10, ranging from about a $3,500 entry point to over $40,000, right? So that means they have different markets. So there's different kinds of customers and different kinds of activity. And then they went into this whole other market. They built these pipe crawling robots. And it turns out a lot of the insides of that pipe crawling robot are derived from those other robots. So their bill of materials is kept down, their service and support burden is kept down. So this company has done a really excellent job of product development and product insertion into diverse markets. And again, it's a local Canadian entrepreneur story in ocean tech. So you can take that path too. You don't have to raise a ton of venture capital. Sort of my last story, I call this an emerging success. The Deep Trekker folks are profitable and making money and in a position to have an exit, sort of if they so choose. This company is just getting started. It's about 18 months old. But what's really pretty interesting is if you look back at those early autonomous underwater vehicles I showed you, some of those have delivery cycles from order to delivery of over 6 months, sometimes 9 months. So you want one of those big, expensive, complex robots, you place the order and you get it 9 months later. In about 18 months, this company went from idea to product to having delivered a few dozen products into the market and won several interesting, pretty meaningful research funding programs in the defense area, right? How did they do that? Wait a minute, what's the deal, right? They also went through and really optimized things like hydrodynamics, streamlining, electrical burden, and all of that, again, comes out of this kind of industry, right? So the point is that the consumer electronics industry and others like it are driving the technology components in a way that a fast, agile company got a whole new product on the market. And it's not as compelling if you're not in the ocean space, but the product performance of this small vehicle that you see that gentleman holding in his hands is in some cases almost equivalent to some of those much more sophisticated and expensive ones that you saw on the first slide. So it's a pretty neat story. Another sidebar is what you see going on down here. It's more interesting to the advanced tech geeks. It's a new battery technology that uses seawater to essentially, I'm not a chemical engineer, but I call it burning aluminum. So your aluminum is your fuel, you combine it with seawater, it generates electricity. So that same robot, right, you see these are AA batteries, right, you've got a good sense of scale there. It's good for maybe 8 hours, right, maybe 50, 60 kilometers. With this aluminum seawater battery pack, it'll do 1,000 kilometers in one battery pack. So again, you've got major performance improvements. And the last piece of the puzzle that's really exciting, that vehicle, including a sensor, is $15,000, right? So again, you heard me earlier talking about 150 into millions, right? Now you've got something you can buy 10 for the price of one of the other ones. I'm convinced, I'm calling it an emerging success because they haven't had an exit and they're a pretty young company, but I'm convinced that there's a huge market here and you're gonna start to see this shake things up. So all these entrepreneurial stories, there's more, right? There's still more out there. There are 5 different ocean robot technologies on this slide. One of the things they all have in common is they were all founded by people who didn't start in the ocean space. They weren't an oceanographer at Dow. They weren't, a Navy person who came out. All of these came from outside the ocean space. They pretty much all drew on crowdfunding, right? So you can see that's actually a screenshot from an Indiegogo campaign, Kickstarter campaigns. And what they've done is sort of most of these are aimed at giving sort of an individual person the access underwater. Just like anybody here own a drone? Really? I'm the only one who bought a drone? Oh, come on, guys. They're dirt cheap. So I bought a drone. I can fly over my house and take pictures of my chimney. Woohoo! Right? But it's actually kind of cool, and you can start to do neat things, and you start to realize I could also build a 3D model of my house. I can get some software, and I can fill that in, and maybe there's some value add there. They're trying to do the same thing and democratize getting your eyeballs underwater, right? So you've got price points here from, I think, the bottom left product is called Fathom, and they're going to try to hit under $1,000 so that you can go and see basically 100, 150 feet deep and drive around this little thing and explore on your own. That's, again, a pretty big shift. So all of these folks have come in. They've used another mechanism, right? We've talked about VC funding. We've talked about Bootstrap, right? We talked about Riptide, who've drawn a lot of non-dilutive funding out of government research contracts. And then these folks who've taken sort of a crowdsourcing, and they all have pretty good websites, and you can put in a credit card number and ship your product, right? So those are multiple ways that people are bringing businesses into the space. So to draw this to a close, this slide is meant for a different purpose. What is the opportunity? This is aimed at sort of an advanced technology ecosystem where all the different pieces we use to study the ocean come together and collaborate. But the same, I like it because it shows you a lot of interesting things going on there. If you don't want to build one of those because it seems too hard, you can look at a ship. And I can assure you, if you're good with software or instrumentation or electronics or even just business processes, if you look at what goes on with ships or with aircraft or with drones or with satellites in this space, there are so many opportunities to insert advanced technology and innovative businesses that same ecosystem that we're bringing together to do good for the planet and science, et cetera, is a huge opportunity set, I think, for entrepreneurs.